What is going on, guys? Bengalina here, coming back at you with another video, and today we are back with another redraft. We had another draft do-over for you guys, and this is the 2015 NFL draft do-over. You guys remember Jameis Winston went to the Bucs with the number one overall selection, but in this kind of fantasy world where we're living, we're redrafting the draft with the knowledge that we have today. However, with the teams having the knowledge that we do today of how the players turn out, one thing they do not have is the knowledge of the 2016 NFL draft. So they don't know any of their draft picks that happened in those years would pan out. You know what I mean? So let's say, for example, that the Titans take Mariota at number two, which happened in real life in 2015. And let's say, for example, they didn't do that, right? And they made another selection in that draft, like, you know, just a change, not with the redraft. And then there was another really good quarterback that they drafted the next year who's an absolute stud. Let's say they take Carson Wentz in that draft, and clearly they wouldn't need a quarterback because they have Carson Wentz. I know Titans don't have Carson Wentz. Clearly the Eagles do. But they wouldn't have the knowledge of their next year's pick, so they would still be needy at the quarterback position even if they were to draft Carson Wentz. So it's kind of a weird combo of knowledge of right now, but also knowledge of a year or two ago. So I guess without further ado, it's going to be easier if you guys just see it in action. Let's get into the number one overall pick. So in the 2015 NFL draft, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers selected Jameis Winston with the number one overall pick. And with the first pick of the 2015 NFL draft do-over, the Tampa Bay Bucs select Jameis Winston, quarterback out of Florida State. I don't think this should really be a surprise to anyone. The only real argument you could make is potentially the Bucs going Marcus Mariota over Jameis Winston. I think they're going to be more than happy with their 23-year-old. Just, I think stud quarterback is the correct word for him. Tremendous on-field leader. Just has to develop into that player that the Bucs drafted him to be. Ton of potential. I don't see any way why the Bucs would change up this pick. Let's move on to the Titans at number two. So the Titans, as I said earlier, would end up selecting Marcus Mariota out of Oregon with the second overall pick. And with the second overall pick in this draft do-over, the Tennessee Titans select Marcus Mariota, quarterback, Oregon. He's played very well so far in the NFL, not having a phenomenal season this year. However, despite injuries kind of holding back his career, he's been off to a great start. Mariota has been very, very solid, and he's only continuing to get better again. We're talking about such young players in the NFL. He's only 23 right now, so, or maybe he's 24. This game doesn't update year-round. But at the start of the season, he was at least 23. He may still be, I'm not sure. Very good quarterback for the Titans. I'm sure he's going to continue to get better. And yeah, probably top 15 quarterback right now. But let's go ahead and move on to the third pick. So with the third pick in the 2015 NFL draft, the Jags went ahead and selected Dante Fowler Jr., a pass rusher out of Florida. And I think it's somewhat safe to say that Dante Fowler Jr. hasn't really became that number three overall pick that they would have wanted him to be, right? And a guy like Yannick Ngakoue has played extremely well. And Dante Fowler Jr., he's come on this season. He's had a good season. But I don't think for his career so far, he's been really what a number three overall pick is supposed to be. So we are going to change up this selection and have the Jags take Amari Cooper, wide receiver out of Alabama. Has been an absolute monster ever since coming into the NFL. Had a very, very good rookie season. Arguably could have been the offensive rookie of the year. Of course, you know, he didn't end up winning it. As far as I can recall, but he has been phenomenal. This year hasn't really been necessarily a step back other than numbers wise. He still played well. He still had a crazy game just a few weeks ago as I'm recording this. However, very good player. Jags get themselves a stud wide receiver to pair with AR-15 and Allen Robinson. Let's move on to the number four overall selection. Next on the clock is the Oakland Raiders, who ended up selecting Amari Cooper with that fourth overall pick. Amari Cooper is no longer on the board as he goes at number three to the Jaguars. Raiders got themselves a very good player with that pick, but they have to mix it up now. They cannot go Amari Cooper again when he's already been drafted by the Jaguars. So the Raiders instead will select Danielle Hunter. Pass rusher out of LSU has been phenomenal for the Vikings thus far. Arguably a top 10 pass rusher, I think, in the NFL, at least in a 4-3 scheme. As that 4-3 defensive end, he's been so good, and he hasn't really even been starting for the Vikings. I'm not sure if he is this year, but last year he did not start for the Vikings. You had Everson Griffin and Brian Robeson on those edges, and then Danielle Hunter was more of a situational guy, and he dominated in that role, picking up double-digit sacks And the Raiders have been struggling for pass rushers. You do have Khalil Mack, who in my mind is at least a top five defensive player in the league, if not even higher, top three, top two, number one even. You could easily make a case for the former defensive player of the year last year. But Danielle Hunter on the other side would be wreaking absolute havoc. Raiders get themselves a stud pass rusher in this redraft. Back to the actual draft, where the Redskins would select Brandon Scherff with the fifth pick. He still is available on the board, and the Redskins will select in this redraft Brandon Scherff, tackle slash guard out of Iowa. Of course, he plays guard now. He is a Pro Bowl guard, and I debated on changing this one up, but I think when you have a player that's just been so solid for you at, you know, a position that's so important in the NFL, there really wouldn't be much reason to change it. So the Redskins play it safe here and take their Pro Bowl right guard. And let's move on to the next pick, which I believe is the Jets, if I'm not mistaken, where Leonard Williams ended up falling to them in the draft, and he still is available. Yeah, with the sixth pick, the Jets would take Leonard Williams, a defensive lineman, out of USC. And with the sixth pick in this draft do-over, the New York Jets select Leonard Williams, a 3-4 defensive end, out of USC. I think this pick makes a lot of sense for the Jets, obviously. They did it with kind of a stacked defensive line at the time with Sheldon Richardson, the defensive rookie of the year, with Muhammad Wilkerson. It's like, where are you really going to find space for Leonard Williams? But they did, and he's really the only true player I can see staying on the Jets, because Sheldon Richardson obviously is no longer on the Jets. He's in Seattle. Muhammad Wilkerson could be on his last leg with the Jets. He could be moving on very easily. Leonard Williams has played very well. Still, obviously, everyone in this draft is incredibly young right now. Leonard Williams can improve. Still, tremendous player, though. Jets are going to keep the same pick as we move on to the seventh pick. With the seventh pick, the Bears would select Kevin White, a receiver out of West Virginia who showed so much promise, but unfortunately, through injuries, he has barely seen the field at all. I think it'd be silly, even with the potential of Kevin White, to draft him here with the seventh overall pick. So the West Virginia standout wide receiver will not be this selection at number seven, but it will be Marcus Peters, a cornerback out of Washington. He's put up very, very good numbers so far in the NFL, including a Defensive Rookie of the Year nomination, and then of course he did end up winning that. So Marcus Peters is someone that's put up extremely good numbers, a lot of interceptions, has played well for the Chiefs. The Bears take themselves that cornerback that they wanted in Kyle Fuller and haven't really been able to find. Really helps out their secondary at the time. And he's going to, you know, still play as well as he did, we'd assume, with the Bears now. And they're really amping up that secondary. With the eighth pick, the Atlanta Falcons would go Vic Beasley, a pass rusher out of Clemson. And with the eighth pick, the Atlanta Falcons will select Vic Beasley, a pass rusher out of Clemson. I think he notched 16 and a half sacks last year, which was a tremendous, tremendous season, as I think he won Defensive Rookie of the Year, or maybe he was the runner-up. I guess Marcus Peters and Vic Beasley could not have both won it. So yeah, Vic Beasley must have been the runner-up, although I don't know why I feel like he definitely won it. I feel like Marcus Peters definitely won Defensive Rookie of the Year. I don't know, although I'm pretty sure. Vic Beasley has been tremendous for the Falcons. You can't go any other player than Vic Beasley. You know what? Vic Beasley did it in his second year. No. Hold on. Jesus. Yeah, all right. Last year, Vic Beasley got the sacks. With the experience being 2 years, it's kind of screwing me up. But he's into his third year. I was trying to wrap my head around that. Yeah, Vic Beasley had 16 and a half sacks last year, which led the NFL. There's no way the Falcons would change that, especially still being needy at that pass rusher position. They would end up taking Tack McKinley in the next year's draft, which obviously hasn't existed in this time period yet. So yeah, Falcons, don't mix it up. I don't know why this pick took so long for me to get out, but yeah, Vic Beasley is the clear pick here. And with the ninth pick, the New York Giants would select Eric Flowers, one of the worst players to ever put on pads. Very unfortunate. He has been an absolute disaster, and I know he's made strides this year, which they've been baby steps, if anything. He's still not good. Like, improving from the worst in the league to no longer the worst, but still up there, that's not good. It doesn't matter if you've improved. Giants are mixing up this selection. There's no way I have them going Eric Flowers again, let alone at number 9. Not even in the top 5 rounds would I have Eric Flowers going. There's not even a chance. But the Giants instead will select David Johnson, a running back out of Northern Iowa, has exploded onto the scene. He did tear his ACL this year, out for the season, but has been so good in the NFL prior to that injury. Had a very good rookie season, an even better second season in the NFL, and of course, injury hit. But the Giants take that superstar running back that they haven't had since a Tiki Barber, really. I know Brandon Jacobs had a few good seasons for the Giants, and Ahmad Bradshaw and Derek Warr even rushed for over 1,000 yards. I'm a Giants fan. But David Johnson would take a lot of the heat off Eli. He can do a lot behind a really poor offensive line. Really changes up what the offense is capable of. David Johnson to the Giants. He's now a top 10 pick. At number 10, at the time, St. Louis Rams would select Todd Gurley, a running back out of Georgia. And in this draft do-over, the Rams select Todd Gurley, running back out of Georgia. Very, very good rookie season for David Johnson. Not David. Well, that's true. But also for Todd Gurley. Todd Gurley had a great rookie season. And then people were saying he regressed with a terrible offensive line, no weapons. So it's pretty much the only play call for the Rams. Defenses knew what it was. Hand the ball off to Todd Gurley. His yards per carry were down. His yards were down. His touchdowns were down. But this year, he's come back with a vengeance now that the Rams actually have an offensive coordinator and head coach that are competent with each other. Jared Goff, who's been a pretty good quarterback so far this year. An offense that clicks. Todd Gurley has been back to that player that we knew he was going to be coming out of Georgia. Rams don't mix it up at all. With the 11th pick in the 2015 NFL draft, the Minnesota Vikings would select Trey Waynes. Cornerback out of Michigan State with wheels, could absolutely fly. However, he hasn't really developed into anything in the NFL. He wasn't that cornerback that they took. I mean, you look at them now, they do have Xavier Rhodes. Terrence Newman has played incredibly well, even though he is 38 years old. He is ancient. However, they're not going to take Trey Waynes again. They're going to address a different player in this draft with this pick, and that player is going to be Landon Collins, a safety out of Alabama, had one of the worst rookie seasons I've ever seen, but then bounced back with a Pro Bowl season, arguably could have been Defensive Player of the Year, had an incredible season. He's still playing pretty well this season, despite the Giants being fairly poor on defense, and of course, overall, they're like, what, 1-8, 1-9? They're awful. I think it's 1-8. It's been deplorable being a Giants fan, and now one of the Giants' best players is headed elsewhere, and that is to Minnesota to help out with that secondary. And now you have Xavier Rhodes, one of the top cornerbacks in the NFL. Harrison Smith, one of the top safeties in the NFL, and now you add another. They're solidifying one of the best secondaries now in the NFL with Landon Collins, who would turn into a stud. And then at number 12, the Cleveland Browns would select Danny Shelton, defensive tackle out of Washington, and Danny Shelton has not been bad. Danny Shelton's been a very good nose tackle. However, I have the Browns mixing it up here with kind of a very Browns-esque pick, and that's going to be Ronald Darby. He's someone that had a dominant rookie season for the Buffalo Bills and then got traded to the Eagles. He had a very good preseason. I haven't really heard too much about him since then, but I think considering the level that he played at in his rookie season, the Browns would say, hey, you can potentially evolve into one of the best corners in the NFL. I know he hasn't exactly been that, but he's still a decent player. And I think with his potential, the Browns are going to take that player and hope that he can evolve into something phenomenal. So they don't have Jason McCourty at the time. Breanbody Calhoun is not good. Jamar Taylor is not good. Joe Hayden is on his way out. They need a cornerback. Ronald Darby's that guy. Maybe he can become something sick with the Browns. With the 13th pick in the 2015 NFL draft, the New Orleans Saints would select Andres Pete, a tackle out of Stanford. Absolute giant. Absolute giant. They ended up moving him inside to guard, I believe. He was formerly a tackle. And in this pick, we are going to draft a guard. However, it is not Andres Pete. It is a different player, helping solidify that offensive line like they wanted to, but with a bit of a better player, and that player will be Shaq Mason, a right guard out of Georgia Tech. Go Yellow Jackets. I don't know why, but someone's got to root for him, I guess. Although they're pretty good now, to be fair. Anyway, Shaq Mason's done an incredible job of both protecting Tom Brady and helping out the run game in there. Part of the reason that a guy like Mike Gillisley can get 3 touchdowns on a given Sunday. Sunday? Thursday? What day did the NFL season start? Chiefs, Patriots. Mike Gillisley had 3 rushing touchdowns. I don't remember what day it was. I can't for the life of me remember. However, Shaq Mason, instrumental offensive lineman for the Patriots, very good player. Saints would be very happy to add them to their squad. Add them? There's one of them. There's one Shaq Mason. We're moving on. With the 14th pick, the Miami Dolphins would select Devontae Parker, a receiver out of Louisville. And Devontae Parker is someone for me that had a lot of potential and has played fairly well in the NFL so far. I'm not saying he hasn't. He's been very good in the NFL. However, I think they'd be better off taking a better caliber player at this instance in time. So with that pick, the Miami Dolphins are going to select Stephon Diggs, a receiver out of Maryland. He's someone that I had ranked pretty highly, and I was very surprised that he ended up dropping as far as he did in the draft. And he's had a very, very good NFL career so far. Arguably, I would say the best receiver in this draft class. I think you could make that argument. I mean, Amari Cooper is very, very talented, and we had him going at 3 in this redraft. However, I think Stephon Diggs, although they're similar type players, I think Amari Cooper is just maybe a little bit more valuable in terms of a pick. Even though Stephon Diggs has been phenomenal, I know this is kind of a wishy-washy one. I think you could flip-flop them either way. Just for right now, though, I have Stephon Diggs in this position. Tremendous receiver. Exactly what the Dolphins wanted when they took Devontae Parker, who isn't bad by any means. I think that Stephon Diggs right now is just a little bit better. Or maybe more than a little bit. With the 15th pick in the draft, the San Diego Chargers at the time would select Melvin Gordon, a running back out of Wisconsin. And with this pick, the San Diego Chargers are going to select Melvin Gordon, a running back out of Wisconsin. Had a pretty horrific rookie season, I won't lie, but then came back and had a tremendous, tremendous second season. I think he made a Pro Bowl, if we could check back. I'm pretty sure he made a Pro Bowl last year. Very, very good season. He's now an 89 overall in Madden. Not that that's extremely relevant. However, good player. Is having a bit of a down year this year, but I don't see any reason why the now Los Angeles Chargers would change up this pick when they've got such a good player in Melvin Gordon. He's going to stay with the Chargers. With the 16th pick in the draft, the Houston Texans would take Kevin Johnson, a cornerback, out of Wake Forest. And Kevin Johnson might have something to say about that.
What's going on? This is Kevin Johnson with the Houston Texans. Make sure y'all subscribe to Bengal on YouTube. You know what I'm saying? Get with the churn, baby.
Melvin Gordon did make a Pro Bowl, by the way, and thank you for that, Kevin Johnson. However, the Texans are not going to take Kevin Johnson here. I'm sorry. They're going to change it up. Texans take with this pick Bernardrick McKinney, a middle linebacker out of Mississippi State. Very, very good player. I think maybe he's not the best inside linebacker in this draft class. Of course, we do have Jordan Hicks, who would go much later out of Texas, Hook'em Horns. I think Jordan Hicks is a little bit better of a player. They just play different roles, and I think Bernardrick McKinney, as you've seen so far in Houston, has fit that role in that scheme much, much better than a guy like Jordan Hicks would. I think he plays at a higher potential. I think Bernardrick McKinney wouldn't work in Philadelphia's system the way he does in Houston, and vice versa with Jordan Hicks and Philadelphia. He plays so well in Philly, I don't think he'd play the same in Houston. So we are going to take a player that Houston ended up drafting anyway. I think a Pro Bowl caliber player. I'm not sure if he snuck in last year. I think he should have, but I'm not sure if he did. Regardless, though, Bernardrick McKinney, very, very good player. Texans take themselves a player that they would draft later. They have to draft him now because I figure another team would jump up in front and grab him before they could draft him again. So Bernardrick McKinney is a top 16 pick now. Also, in case you're curious, I look for an excuse to throw that Kevin Johnson clip anytime I can. Anytime it's maybe a little bit relevant, it's in there. However, on a different note, the 49ers would take Eric Armstead, a defensive lineman out of Oregon, with the 17th pick in the 2015 NFL draft. However, in the 2015 NFL draft do-over, the San Francisco 49ers select Jordan Hicks, a middle linebacker out of Texas, again, Hook'em Horns. I know this is kind of weird because I was just talking about how he wouldn't fit in that Texan system. And at the time, the 49ers were still in a 3-4. However, I think they have a little bit less of a need for a thumper, and cover linebackers are really successful in that scheme. So you have Navarro Bowman, who's a very good middle linebacker at the time on that team, as that thumper role. And then a guy like Patrick Willis, who they could never really fully replace. Maybe Jordan Hicks can be that guy, who is a tremendous cover linebacker. Of course, he could do it all. But I think Jordan Hicks can come in, play that cover linebacker role, and really create a great tandem with the Navarro Bowman. And yeah, I think he's the right pick for the 49ers here. With the 18th pick in the draft, the Kansas City Chiefs would select Marcus Peters, a cornerback out of Washington. He is notably no longer on this board as he went, I believe, at number 7 to the Bears. Yes, number 7 to the Bears. So they have a need for a different player. You can't take Marcus Peters again. So here's what the Chiefs do. They go ahead and select Lael Collins, an offensive lineman out of LSU, and you could play him anywhere. You have a hole at a certain position, plug in Lael Collins. He's your guy. Can play left tackle, left guard, right tackle. Hell, you wanted to, he could probably even play center. Although I've never seen him do it. That's not to say that it's never happened. Although I just don't think it has. He was supposed to be a first round pick coming out of LSU until like there was a murder investigation where it was somebody that he knew. And the police were like, yeah, it wasn't Lael Collins. And NFL teams were like, it could have been though. And the cops were like, it wasn't. And then the team come to the draft and just don't take Lael Collins. They're like, nah, maybe he did it though. I'm like, all right. So Lael Collins ended up signing, or actually he was taken, I believe, in the supplemental draft by the Cowboys. Pretty sure he wasn't just flat out signed. And he's played, I think, pretty well for the Cowboys so far, despite moving around at so many different positions on the line. I've seen him get starts at left tackle, left guard, and right tackle. I don't think he's ever gotten a start at right guard. But he's their starting right tackle right now, and he's played pretty well in that spot. Chiefs take one of the best offensive linemen on the board, a very versatile player, and really help out that offensive line. At number 19, the Browns would totally Browns it and take Cameron Irving, a center out of Florida State. He's not a center. He played his best football at left tackle, if I recall, for Florida State, and then kind of moved to center, and it didn't really work out. So I think they're going to go ahead and mix up this pick. And they're going to take Mitch Morse, center, out of Missouri, out of Mizzou. Very, very good center. He's played very well in the NFL so far. 25 years old, not rated that highly in Madden, but he's a quality starting center. He had a good rookie season, an even better second season. I'm not exactly sure how well he's been playing this year. However, I think he's a quality center, of course. The Browns didn't go out and sign all those offensive linemen at the time, so there's no J.C. Treader, there's no whoever else they signed, because they signed Kevin Zeitler, but at center, I mean. So J.C. Treader is not on the team. They need a center. Cam Irving is not the guy. Mitch Morse is the new pick. Ends up going in the first round this time instead of the second, is where I think he went last time. With the 20th pick, the Philadelphia Eagles would select Nelson Agholor, a receiver out of USC, I believe. Is it USC? It is. It is USC. However, Nelson Agholor, up until this year, has never really put up any type of numbers. He has 5 touchdowns so far this year in a couple of games. Not a couple. He's played, 9 or 10. So he is putting up better numbers than he has in the past, but I would say overall he's been a bust up until this year, and it's arguably because of Carson Wentz that he's finally playing up to any level. So Nelson Agholor will not be the pick. Sorry to Eagles fans who maybe are huge fans of him now. But we're going to mix it up and go ahead and take Eric Kendricks, the middle linebacker out of UCLA. Someone that could play the Jordan Hicks role very, very well. They're similar players. They're athletic. They can tackle. But also, they have good coverage abilities. Now, Eric Kendricks is nowhere near the level of Jordan Hicks in coverage abilities, in my opinion. However, he still has better than average cover abilities, and he's extremely fast, which, of course, helps out with that. I think he would fit this Philadelphia system so well. So he is the pick to the Eagles in this draft do-over. With the 21st pick in the draft, the Bengals would select Cedric Obuehi, offensive lineman out of Texas A&M. He was actually a really highly ranked tackle for a while for Texas A&M. He was a projected top 5 draft pick who just did not ever develop the strength that you need to play that position. And he ended up falling off, I think, a lot, ended up dropping to the 21st overall pick where the Bengals grabbed him. Bengals are going to go ahead and mix this up. They're not taking Cedric Obuehi again. But they are going to take David Irving, a defensive tackle out of Iowa State. Now, I think you could kind of move him all over the line. I think with this Bengals system, though, he would fit best at defensive tackle. Even though he isn't an incredible run stuffer, he's a guy that's going to get after the quarterback. And I think with 2 guys that can really do that at an extremely high level in Geno Atkins and now David Irving on the team, you're going to get an extremely dominant pass rushing interior and a defensive line as a whole, especially with Carlos Dunlap playing left end. So David Irving is the pick to the Bengals in this redraft. I think they get themselves a pretty good player instead of Cedric Ogbuehi. At number 22, the Pittsburgh Steelers would select Alvin Bud Dupree, an outside linebacker, a defensive end, a pass rusher out of Kentucky. One of my favorite players coming into the draft at the position. Really liked him in terms of ability. And I think the Steelers, with this pick, will select Bud Dupree, pass rusher out of Kentucky. He's also shown that he can, if need be, drop back into coverage. He's an extremely athletic player, someone that can absolutely straight out fly, getting after the quarterback. Very, very good player. I think 77 overall. Again, not that that's relevant, but I think that's a little bit undercutting his ability. Should be closer to that 80 overall mark, 80, 81 in my opinion. But he is a very good player. I think the Steelers will take the exact same pick. With the 23rd pick in the draft, the Denver Broncos would select Shane Ray, another pass rusher out of Mizzou. And he was a weird one. He was pretty dominant at Mizzou. However, it was said that his abilities wouldn't really translate to the NFL level, I think, because he was like a tweener. A little bit too light for his position, but not necessarily athletic enough to play as a real linebacker. But the Denver Broncos, with this pick, nevertheless, will select Shane Ray. Even with the whole, like, you know, maybe he's into marijuana a lot, or he's doing the pot, as they say. Shane Ray, though, has been pretty productive so far for the Broncos. He hasn't played a ton, which means that his sack numbers aren't exactly inflated, but he still does have potential, obviously, with everyone in this class. Still very, very young, has a lot of time to improve. And I think the Broncos take the exact same pick here at number 22, something like that. All right, it was pick number 23. However, the Cardinals at 24 would go DJ Humphries, an offensive tackle out of Florida, someone that's played pretty well so far in the NFL. However, there are better players here at this spot that they could have picked instead now in this draft do-over. With that being said, the Arizona Cardinals at pick number 24 select Devontae Parker, receiver out of Louisville. He's someone that has played very well now that he's been healthy and on the field for the Dolphins, making incredible catches, showing off his athleticism, jumping ability, his deep threat with the speed. Very good player. I like him a lot. I think he only has room to improve. He could eventually be a top receiver in the NFL, maybe not top five. I think top 15 for sure, as he actually quickly approaches that, in my opinion. Not quite there yet, but he is approaching it. Good player. Really, really fun player to watch when he's healthy and on the field making plays. That's who the Cardinals go. Give whoever their quarterback happens to be another target. I know it's Carson Palmer at this time, but he can't be their long-term plan. Gives another guy next to Larry Fitz. John Brown was good at this time, but you just needed another guy who can play on the outside, and it isn't Jerron Brown. Devontae Parker is the pick here at number 24. At number 25, the Panthers would select Shaq Thompson, an outside linebacker out of Washington. Also played a lot of running back at Washington, if I recall, as you see a bunch of guys out there in that Pac-12 doing that. That's where UCLA is, pretty sure, with Miles Jack playing linebacker and halfback. They're a little bit wild out there in the West Coast. That's why I don't trust it. The West Coast, that is. I don't trust it. Just kidding. Not though. We're moving on. Panthers select Tyler Lockett, a receiver out of K-State, Kansas State. Tyler Lockett, very, very versatile player. Arguably a switch army knife. Not maybe to the level of Tyreek Hill or some players like that. But he's someone that has taken handoffs successfully in the past. Someone that can return kicks extremely successfully. Really good slot receiver. And I think a reason why Tyler Lockett makes a lot of sense to me here is you do take Curtis Samuel, a player who's extremely similar in a lot of ways in the following drafts. And Tyler Lockett is essentially that player in a lot of ways. So I think he helps out this offense. Maybe gives Cam Newton another target, because at the time they do have Kelvin Benjamin. You do have Devin Funchess, but that's kind of it. You need one of those slot guys to make plays, and Devin Funchess isn't incredible. So Tyler Lockett is that guy here. Panthers select him at number 26 maybe? Something like that. At number 26, the Ravens would go the speedy receiver out of UCF, in Brashad Perriman. Not my pick. Not my pick. He didn't go to Alabama, so that's kind of weird for Ozzie Newsome. However, with this pick, the Ravens will select Jay Ajayi, a halfback out of Boise State. Buckin' Broncos, go team. Someone with injury concerns coming out the J train, dropped in the draft. I believe went in the third round, if I'm not mistaken. But he's someone that for the Dolphins was a very, very good player when healthy. Had a very good game already this season, then came back, got traded for a fourth round pick to the Eagles. Neither team's going to get him. It's the Ravens. They take this first round running back now, and they don't look back. Extremely good player. Takes the heat off Joe Flacco. You could argue maybe at this time you need a wide receiver a bit more, but you can't pass up on the J train when he's available at a position of need right now. Ravens take their halfback. At number 27, the Dallas Cowboys would select Byron Jones, a cornerback out of UConn. Would break the record for longest broad jump ever. And with this pick, the Dallas Cowboys select Byron Jones, cornerback out of UConn. Of course, they ended up converting it to safety, where he's played pretty well. Hasn't been, you know, a Pro Bowl caliber player just yet, but he still has potential. He's been somewhat solid back there. I think the Cowboys, knowing with how well he's played, knowing his athletic abilities and his potential versatility, would go Byron Jones again. With the 28th overall pick, the Lions would take Laken Tomlinson, a guard out of Duke, who isn't even on the team. I think he's on the 49ers now. He hasn't really turned out to be much. They're not going to go Laken Tomlinson at all. They're going a different direction. And that direction is going to be Kevin Johnson. Roll the clip. Just kidding. You guys have already seen it. I do want to put it in again. We're not going to. Kevin Johnson, cornerback out of Wake Forest, obviously went much earlier in the draft. I think number 16 to the Texans, if that's what the number was. It doesn't really matter. However, he went so much earlier in the draft. He falls now to the Lions, and if he can stay healthy, he can be a very, very good player. Lions get themselves a guy to play next to Darius Slay. Quandre Diggs is on the team at the time. That's a really good trio of cornerbacks, especially Quandre Diggs playing that nickel role where he excels so much. Darius Slay and Kevin Johnson on the outside. That'd be a lethal combo if Kevin Johnson can develop around them. It's not a bad secondary, especially with Glover Quinn out there playing free safety. With the 29th overall pick, the Colts would take Philip Dorsett, a receiver out of Miami. Another guy who's just a speed threat, kind of reminiscent of a Nelson Agholor. And he's not even on the team anymore. He's now with the Patriots. Colts are going a different direction. And with this pick, they will select Andres Pete, an offensive lineman out of Stanford. He plays left guard now for the Saints. However, I don't really think that's his best natural position. At 6'7", 316, I think he's a surprisingly athletic offensive tackle. That's where I really liked him at Stanford. I think he could be a very good tackle in this league, you know, provided given the chance to develop, become a better player. Gotta protect Andrew Luck. I think you can never have enough offensive linemen who are quality. Andres Pete can turn into a very quality offensive lineman. Perhaps you play him to replace Anthony Costanzo. Perhaps you put him on the other side. Maybe you do play him at guard. I'm not sure, but they're taking him with this pick. And with the 30th pick, the Green Bay Packers would select Demarius Randall, a safety out of Arizona State. I love Demarius Randall, Demarius, however you want to say it, at Arizona State as a free safety. I thought he was someone that could be potentially reminiscent of an Earl Thomas. Not to the same ability, same degree, obviously, but I thought he had the same kind of skill set, but at a lower level. Packers go ahead and take him and say, you play cornerback now. That's what they do. They take safeties and they're like, you play cornerback now. And it has not worked out. You got to take cornerbacks to play cornerbacks, safeties to play safeties. I've been extremely disappointed with Demarius Randall so far because I think his career has been a waste. I think he would have been so much better at free safety. And I think that once he gets off the Packers, because he's not going to play safety now, with Morgan Burnett and Clinton Dix, whatever you want to say, he needs to go elsewhere if he can really play up to his full potential and play safety. He can't be the pick anymore. We're going another guy, and that guy is Malcolm Brown, a defensive tackle out of Texas, someone that has played so well so far for the Patriots at the kind of nose tackle role, replacing Vince Wilfork. He's going now to the Packers. He's being their stud defensive tackle on the inside. Love this pick for the Packers. I know it's not that cornerback that they so desperately need, but I'm not going to have them reach for a cornerback. that isn't as good when a player that still is at a position of need for them at the time, at defensive tackle in Malcolm Brown, they're taking him. It's really a no-doubter pick. No, it makes so much sense for me. Malcolm Brown to the Packers at number 30. At number 31, the New Orleans Saints would select Stephon Anthony, inside linebacker out of Clemson. He hasn't really done much for the Saints. It's been unfortunate, but it's also been the reality. It's busts happen. They do. And not that he's necessarily a bust, because he's kind of taken later. He's not a stellar player. I don't think a first-round caliber player, unfortunately, despite all the athleticism. And the Saints are going a different guy. And that player with the 31st overall pick is going to be Frank Clark, defensive end out of Michigan. Someone that's played well. He had character concerns and a bunch of off-the-field issues, and that's why he dropped. But he's always been a first-round caliber player. He's played very well for the Seahawks, who don't really seem to care about character at all. They say, if you can get your act together and play for our football team, we're going to draft you, and you're going to play up to your abilities. They've kept him in check. Frank Clark has been very good so far for the Seahawks, a big part of their defensive line improvement over the past couple of years. And a big fan of Frank Clark. He's going with the Saints, helping out that pass rush in the 2015 NFL draft do-over. And with the final first-round pick, the New England Patriots would take Malcolm Brown, a defensive tackle out of Texas. However, there's a problem. Malcolm Brown is no longer available. He just went a couple of picks ago to the Packers. Patriots got to go a different direction. Well, they could go the same direction, but they got to go a different player. And that player is going to be Marcus Golden, another pass rusher out of Mizzou. This seems like such a Patriots-esque pick to me. A player that, you know, wasn't extremely highly sought after going to the draft, but a player that could potentially play in your hybrid scheme, still go after the passer. I'm a big fan of Marcus Golden on the field. He makes plays. He had 12 and a half sacks either, I think it was last year. So he's a player that is easily a first-round caliber pick, could maybe have gone to the Saints. Saints decided to go with Frank Clark. Patriots got to go Marcus Golden here. Very, very good situational or starting pass rusher. However you want to use them, Patriots go with them. But that's going to do it for this video, guys. I hope you enjoyed. If you stayed up here, keep in mind all trades that happened prior to the draft or in the draft. We're going to keep those the same. We're not going to change up the draft order. But that is going to do it for me, guys. I hope you did enjoy. I hope you enjoyed. And I will see you in the next one. Take it easy.